Hello everyone, my name is James and I am the creator of Blood, Sweat, and Steel. And today we're going to talk about one of my favorite aspects of tabletop RPGs, which is physical conflict or combat.
Fuck yeah.
We're going to kill some stuff today.
Ah!
Helping me out today, I've got be to my left, to your right on the screen there, we have Brett. He is of rude craft, and if you'll notice his awesome shirt and my awesome shirt, you can get these online. Got to do the mad pimping. He also has the, he's showing them right there.
I'll pimp off my designs.
As well as tabletop terrain, if you can see this amazing display in the small corner here, window. That's what we're going to be using for our tutorial today for the combat, and we'll put some stuff in the video at the end for context. And also, to my right, your left, is Elise, who is also a very crafty, creative individual and makes these awesome custom dice bags. You can contact me for information. Yeah. As you can see, mine's bigger than Brett's, so
what do you think? It's not the size that counts, it's the dice you got in there.
When it comes to dice bags, size matters.
No.
Okay, so before we dig in too deep, I thought it'd be a good idea to kind of go over some of the basics of conventional RPGs and how this game is a little bit different. So when I get into the rules, it'll make a lot more sense in context. So, there's a couple of elements of Blood, Sweat, and Steel combat that I want to go over. And the first is simultaneous actions. So, in a traditional RPG, you usually have initiative. Everyone rolls for initiative, and everyone takes turns between the good guys and the bad guys, taking their actions and seeing what happens. In a simultaneous combat system, everything kind of happens at once. So it's all considered to be simultaneous. So there's basically two phases to the exchange. The first part phase of the exchange is you describe what your character would like to do, what they're intending to do. Once we have figured all that out, then it's basically opposed roles. So Brett's fighting a bad guy, he wants to attack, the bad guy wants to attack. Whoever wins the opposed role gets their action. So so they would get to do their action. The other side is considered to be reacting to that action. So whoever wins the opposed role, they get to take their action. Which does mean in this game, it's possible to go several exchanges without actually doing anything if you keep losing your action. So it's important in this style of a game to do what your character is really, really good at when it really matters. Kind of important. Another aspect that's a little bit different is there are no hit points in this game. It uses non-linear wounds. So there are four different types of wounds, and I'm going to just pull up the character sheet for a second so you can kind of see here.
Can you pencil?
Yeah. At the bottom, you see there's in the lower left-hand corner of the character sheet, you have minor wounds, you have serious wounds, you have critical wounds, and traumatic wounds. So there are different types of wounds that have different consequences that come with them. We'll go into that in more detail, but basically, instead of tracking hit points, you're tracking wounds. When you get hurt, your character is less able to do stuff, which makes them more susceptible to being really, really hurt and taken out of the game. So we'll explain that a little bit more. The last thing I just wanted to touch on real quick before we actually get into setting up a scene and doing combat is the zone-based movement. So Fate is kind of one of the more popular games out right now that uses that style of movement. So if you're used to a traditional game that uses grids with miniatures and you have like specified movement, you can move six squares or five squares depending on your character, that sort of movement. This is that just kind of more simplified. So the way a zone works is zones are roughly 25 to 30 foot areas. And you basically can move from zone to zone. It's not meant to be very specific. You don't have to put your guy in a specific spot. If you're in a zone with a bunch of combatants, you can attack anybody in that zone. And we'll show how the zones work when we do the setting up the scene on this particular environment. Since it's nice and big, we've got one, two, three, for a good five zones, it looks like, for this particular game. And we'll get into barriers and things like that. So those are the things to really kind of remember when we're going through the combat. Those are the main differences, but as we go through it step by step, we'll cover each of those things. All right, so so we've talked about the two phases of simultaneous actions combat. So the first phase is where you declare what you're intending to do. Now there's really about four things you can do in an average exchange during combat. You can attack, you can defend, you can move, Or you can do a, perform a maneuver, which is like to trip somebody or try to disarm them, something like that. So those are the four basics. But you can describe in as much or little detail what your character wants to do before you do it. And the more information you can give the DM, obviously, the easier it is for them to figure out what's going to happen. And we'll explain how that comes together at the back end of the exchange. So the first step in any combat situation is you need to set the scene. You need to describe what's going on. So we did not set this up ahead of time. They brought their own characters. I don't even know what they're running. So they'll be able to give a kind of a brief little description here of their characters in a second. But what we're basically doing is they have broken into this temple to steal something from the altar. At that point, a couple of guards are going to come in and we're just going to play it out. I wanted to do something basic. So it's two PCs, two NPCs. So it's kind of a one-on-one, mano-a-mano type of a fight. In later videos, we're going to talk about handling large creatures, handling swarms, different types of terrain, and getting into like magic and things like that. So the first thing we're doing is we're setting the scene. So that's what I basically described here. We've got the two players are in the temple. They are at the altar getting ready to steal the prize that they've been hired to get. When two of the guards bust in there, I'm going to go ahead and change the view so you can see what we're looking at here.
Look at that.
And Brett, if you can show them where you guys are, just kind of point where you guys are at.
So this is where I am.
I'm right there.
And that's Bovar Gunvalder. We'll go over the characters. And that's are you playing Perry? Yeah, okay. Playing Perry. This, we determined, is a bottomless pit. So we put a little black card under there just to make it nice and dark down there. And that's where the previous guard is now residing. That we just tossed down there. Yeah, he will be for eternity. So that's us. And then we got two guards over here. Boop, 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 boop. And they just walked in.
So give them a quick little overview of your characters, and then we're gonna the first exchange or two, we're gonna go step by step, really break it down. Mm-hmm. Now these two have played in games before, so they know how the game works. But just for explanation purposes, we're gonna go real slow for the first exchange or two. Then we're just gonna play it out and see what happens. So go ahead and tell them a little about your character.
Sure. I am Bovar Gunvalder. I am a large mountain of a man who carries an even larger axe. This one isn't as large, but it's cool. It's actual metal, so. He's just kind of your modeled after Bulvi from 13th Warrior. Just big, badass Viking. And currently is covered in all kinds of blue war paint or tattoos.
No, it's blood. It's blue blood.
Nice.
Okay. Oh no, I just knocked off all the focus. My bad.
It'll reset.
Anyway, I'll show off paint jobs too. Anyway, so yes, Bovar Gunvalder is the muscle tank of the group.
And I am playing Perry the Perilous. She is a wannabe superstar of a blacksmith. She has a bit of a quirk to her in that she likes to experiment with alchemy as well as usual smithing, and that doesn't always work in her favor, but she tries, and that's what counts. Her main weapon is probably about, would you say, 10 times the size?
Yeah, it's enormous. It's huge. Just ridiculous.
It's about 5 feet tall of a hammer that has a special surprise, but for the purposes of this video, it is a normal great hammer that will destroy, hopefully.
The flattener.
Yeah.
The flattener. Yeah, not Bovar, the hammer, but the flattener joins us this game.
Bovar is quite surprised at how well this tiny framed person wields such an enormous hammer. He's a bit jealous, in fact.
Yeah, she has surprised people before. She's very small.
Yeah.
So at this point we've been playing the game, they've broken into the center chamber, they're at the altar. They're getting ready to steal the prize in the center there, the jewel of the serpent or whatever you want to call it, the eye of the serpent we'll call it. And the two guards are coming in at the top of the screen there. So when a game, there's two modes in Blood, Sweat, and Steel. There's a story mode, and then there's an exchange mode. So the story mode is where we're just talking and riffing, and oh, I'm gonna go talk to the blacksmith, and oh, we're gonna go get a room at the inn, and you're not really tracking time too closely. Exchange mode is where something important is happening, a chase scene, a fight, tense negotiation, something where time matters and turns matter, and how you're kind of zooming in on the action so you can really get more detail. So we're going into exchange, at this point, and exchange is 5 to 7 seconds. It's just a small segment of time, kind of similar to a round in other games. 6 seconds is about the average, 5 or 6 seconds. So it's they can basically try to do anything that would take up that amount of time. So now that we're in the end, we were talking about the zones. So in this this particular environment, we've got several zones. What I would basically count is the altar area is all one zone, that whole middle strip. Then you've got zones to the outside of each side. And then you've got a couple of these raised areas that I would consider other zones. Now, in addition to zones in a zone-based movement, there's also barriers. They could be stairs. They could be let's say you're in an alley and you're between two buildings. You know, climbing up from the floor to the from the ground up to the ceiling, that would be a barrier. And those usually require extra movement or extra time to traverse a barrier. For the purposes of this encounter, the only real barriers we have is if anybody wants to get up to those higher locations in there, that would take some time. So we're basically working with three zones. You've got the center altar area, one zone to each area. So anybody, if you're in the same zone, you can attack anybody in that zone. If you want to attack somebody in an adjacent zone, you can move one zone. You take a -1 penalty to your action, but you can, it's like kind of like charging in to get somebody from a distance. So you can do that. You can also use thrown and ranged weapons into adjacent zones. We can get more into that if it actually comes up. At this point, what I'd like to, and basically I was going to start, I was going to create another little zone there where the guards are just coming into the room, that sort of area between the two, those two areas there. So that's where they're going to start out. So the first part of the exchange is where we declare intent. So I've just described to the players that the guards have busted into the room, swords drawn, ready to take you guys down. What is Bovar going to do?
Bovar shall take the eye of the serpent. I just happen to have this thing. That worked out well. Gonna step down on right on this side of the brazier to get that nice flame up in his face. You know, and he's gonna point at that one, and tell him, you know, come get some type of idea. And my intent is to wait for him to come charge at me, and when he gets close enough, kick this thing, spraying coals and fire and all that crap all over him.
Perfect. So now you've seen what he's planning on doing, then we'll do an opposed roll to determine if he's able to do the things in the way he wants to do them. It all depends on who wins their action. And what is Perry going to do? What does she want to do this exchange?
Perry will do something similar, seeing Bovar doing that, and she's going to sneak, however, on the other side to the other brazier, but with her hammer at the ready, hoping for if he happens to go towards her, she can smack him into the pit.
Excellent. Okay, so now they've described basically what they're going to do. As a GM, I also try to give them clues as to what their opponents are trying to do. So the way I would describe it is, since he's taunting the guard on the right there, that he's going to try to close in and attack Bovar this exchange. The other guard, they'll basically crisscross, is going to go after Perry. So they're going to be rolling at a disadvantage. They're going to have to do a -1 because they're moving from the zone between the rocks there to the altar. So they're going to make and then basically once we know what everyone's going to do, the GM will break the scene down into groups of who's going to be engaging with whom. It's important to know for figuring out if someone's outnumbered. It's also important to figure out so we know who's rolling against whom. So when we're ready to roll, Bovar will be rolling against the guard that's just on the altar there, and Perry will be rolling against the other guard. So let's resolve Bovar first.
Mm-hmm. And am I using brawling or melee weapon? I mean, I guess
What I would be thinking, what you might want to consider is maybe intimidation or something like that. You really try to like get him to come at you. So you might want to do something like that.
Alright, so I got a plus three. I'm trying to remember my words here. Superb. I got a superb.
Okay, and a superb is a plus three.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a good.
Uh-huh.
So you succeeded by two. Mm-hmm. You won your action. So you're able to not... He was already coming towards you.
Mm-hmm.
But since you were taunting him, and giving, he kind of got a little over-anxious. And he kind of stumbled along the way. He's going to be just in front of you at the end of this exchange in perfect position for you to basically try to light him on fire.
Nice.
So now your character is waiting also as well. Now, did you want to try to... You're going to have time... to hit the thing before he gets there if you win. Otherwise, are you just waiting for him to close, like...
Oh, I'm not good at pushing stuff over. I'm going to wait and then physically smack someone.
Ah, gotcha, gotcha. Yeah. Okay. So he's going to try to rush in to you.
I missed. Okay. Okay.
I got a 3 plus a superb, a plus 3 total.
So I rolled a equivalent of 1... plus my superb, so I have a legendary.
No. So,
that's it.
That's all.
So you succeeded by 1. So if you want, so he's going to basically be right in position as he's coming in close. So you're going to have an advantage on the next exchange.
All right, I'm ready.
Yeah.
So you've basically drawn them in. So now you've got them right where you want them. We're to the next exchange now. So we're back to the declaring of the intent.
So we're both like Leonidas here. you're going for the pit. I'm going for the kick. Kind of same diff. So yeah, I'm going to try to kick this flaming brazier. Is that how it's pronounced? Because
brazier.
It's also...
I know it sounds like a bra. Brazier. I can tell you I have a brazier, but close enough.
Okay, so brazier. I'm going to kick into him and hopefully light him on fire.
All right.
Or something. That's my intent.
And Perry?
I am going to try to lunge at him and just bring my hammer slightly at an angle down towards his head, towards the pit, and either, hopefully we'll either smash him or knock him in.
Gotcha.
One
All
of
right.
the two. Real quick, can you swap those?
Oh, let's switch that. Good idea. I'm doing this live, so I don't have a cameraman or an editor or a producer, so I'm going to kind of go as we go here.
And then we do look rather professional here.
All right, so let's go back to Bovar then. Right. He's just basically trying to get around the brazier to attack you,
mm-hmm.
and you're trying to basically light him on fire. Let's see who does better.
So brawling or, I guess brawling?
Brawling.
Brawling, okay. Oh, well, they're the same, so it doesn't really matter.
Ooh!
Okay, so I got... Legendary.
I got a legendary plus 1.
What?
I rolled superb, dude.
Oh my god.
So no fight ever survives the first. No clan ever survives the first round of combat.
Yep.
All right. So because the defender. Now this is one thing that I kind of gotta be clear about. This is not as tight and rules intensive of a game as some others. Mm-hmm. So you really have a lot of freedom to use common sense and the results of the die roll to kind of explain what happened. And the one thing I forgot to mention too, typically speaking in most games, whoever wins the exchange gets to describe the outcome. Once they know what they did or what the outcome is, they get to describe if it's a minor wound or if it's a critical wound or whatever happened. The winner describes. So in this case, the bad guy won the exchange by 1, so I get to describe. So the way I would basically describe it is that he basically avoided getting put on fire. So as Bovar kicks the brazier towards him, he's able to sidestep it, and maybe the brazier actually goes into the pit as you watch the fire slowly disappear into darkness. So he's able to win the action, avoid getting kicked, but he isn't able to really do anything because the brazier was in the way. So the way I would basically describe it is he was able to get close, but he couldn't get an attack because he was too busy getting out of the way, so he didn't start on fire. But now he's got a straight-up matchup for the next exchange. So now we're to Perry's character, and they're going to attack each other, and we'll see how that turns out.
Well, I'm using my hammer, so I would use melee weapons.
Correct.
Okay, then I just have a superb.
Superb, and I also have a superb. So in the event of a tie, and most in a combat situation, it basically is a standoff. They kind of circle, she maybe took a swipe, he ducked back, he poked at her with a sword. They just couldn't really get in, so they're just kind of dancing around that brazier. He's trying to avoid staying into the pit, but nobody's able to land a blow. So basically that round is a standoff, or that exchange. So now that's that exchange. Over. This is going a lot quicker than I thought it was going to go.
Well, two players.
We're already to the third stage. I forgot to mention, this combat system's kind of quick. Because, like I said, you're kind of using a combination of rules and common sense. Now, there are some other things that I did want to touch on real quick. They're more advanced. We're kind of doing the basics, but now that we're already into our third exchange here, there's a couple other elements of the game that to keep in mind when you're playing. One of them is stances. So stances is generally your approach to how you're fighting. So the default is a normal or balanced stance. It's equally offensive and defensive. That's the default, that's just a regular roll. If you want to fight aggressively, which means you're trying to really go after the person, to really do more damage, the way it works, because it's simultaneous actions, you take a -1 to your action. But if you win the action, you get a +2 to your result. So it's kind of like a power attack, and if anyone's familiar with like older versions of D&D, where you take a minus on your to hit, but you get a plus on your damage. It's the same thing, because you're not going to be as accurate, because you're kind of going aggro and trying to swing wildly and do as much damage as possible. Less accurate, but if you do hit, it's extra ouch. So that's the aggressive stance. You can also be cautious. If you want to measure a character, an opponent, you're not quite sure how tough they are, you could get a +1 to your action, but if you win your action, you take a -2 to your result. You're being more cautious, so you're more likely to get your action, but you're not going to have as good a result because you were more worried about avoiding getting hurt than you were of actually doing anything. The third stance you could take is full defense. Full defense basically just gives you a +2 to your action, but even if you win your action, you don't actually do any damage. You're just basically making sure you don't get any ouch time. So those are the stances. And then the other thing that we have, another element, is maneuvers. Maneuvers are basically anything you're trying to do that is like tripping an opponent or tackling someone to the ground, trying to disarm them or take their weapon away. Any type of action like that would be considered a maneuver. Basically, to succeed on a maneuver, you need 3 or more successes to pull off the maneuver. So, for example, if Bovar wanted to try to grab the guard so he could throw him into the pit, that would be a maneuver. If he wins by 3 or more, he gets the hold of the character. There's other rules that after that happens on how to manage it, but that's basically the other two elements I wanted to talk about. So, in addition to your regular attack, move, defend, you've got stances, and you've got maneuvers to try. So now we're going to go into our third exchange. We got basically an even fight at this point. We haven't had any damage. So Bovar, you've got him in front of you. He was able to sidestep the brazier, but now he's looking like he's a little confident.
Yeah, now I'm angry. So quick question. Can you combine an aggressive stance with a maneuver?
Yes.
Okay. I would like to aggressively... I don't know how you possibly guessed exactly what I wanted to do. Not that I'm known for doing certain things. I would like to aggressively grab the guy by the throat and then choke slam him into the pit.
Okay. And he looks like he's just coming at you with his sword. He's got a little swagger because your first little move didn't work. He's got a little grin, so he's just coming in.
That was my ploy, to get him to feel more confident. And I shall exploit this because I'm so smart.
Yes. All right.
And Perry.
Definitely smart.
So you're able to fend him off, but he's looking like he wants to come at you.
All right. I would like to... keeping it simple. I think I would like to try again, but this time I'm just going to bring it straight down onto his head.
All right.
No more pit business.
No more of this pit business.
Regular attack. All right, so Bovar, let's see what happens with the aggressive attack. He's also going aggressive since he was kind of... so this is like two bulls in a china shop going at each other here.
So I get... I get a +1 to my roll, and I have to try to beat him by 4 or by 3.
If you're going aggressive, it's a -1 to your roll. So your roll +2 if you succeed.
Okay, well, we shall see. Let's see how this goes. Ooh, not good. I got a, well, not good, great.
And I got great. A fair. So that means you succeeded by two.
By two, not quite three.
Now here's an interesting, this is a good time to bring this in. One of the elements in our in Blood, Sweat, and Steel is we have a thing called fortune points. So you start out the game with three of them, and a fortune point can basically help you do a lot of things. But the two things it primarily does is it can either give you a reroll or it can give you a plus two to any action. Usually you have to tag one of your qualities of your character to explain how that quality would help you in that situation. And so if Brett wanted to spend a fortune point for Bovar, he would actually succeed in his action. So this gives you a little bit of, like, in case of emergency break glass. It also gives the players a chance with a little more narrative control for if there's something they really want to happen. This allows them to get a little bit of an edge. So he's got plus two, so he did win the exchange, so he can either just take the damage, he'll actually do 4 points of damage, because you get a plus two to your result, which mm-hmm. is a serious wound, pretty serious, or he can spend a fortune point to do the maneuver and succeed.
Well, tell you what, let's show off how these fortune points work. So I would like to use a fortune point, please.
Okay, and what aspect do you think would...
My tribe was once notorious raiders, obviously, and we had kind of a blood-in, blood-out type of thing where I tried to leave the tribe, and they tried to beat the crap out of me, and I succeeded in just brawling my way out, which was the only way out. And in doing so, I did a very similar thing to a guy off the side of a cliff. So I just have this memory of grabbing, you know, Thornak by the throat and chucking him off, you know, the ice bridge or something.
Nice.
Yeah. So I'm just like, I've done this before, you fool. And I grab him by the throat.
All right. So in this maneuver, since the first intent was you're just trying to grab him for this exchange,
mm-hmm.
or are you trying to grab him and throw him in?
Was there a penalty to do them both, or?
No. So the way I would normally adjudicate this, and this is why I love when maneuvers get involved. So you've got a hold of him. That's mm-hmm. not with. That's not. So you can either just hold on to him and then do whatever you want to do for the next exchange, or if you want to try to chuck him in, it'd basically be an opposed brawn check.
I'm good with
so
that.
if you beat him on that, then or otherwise he's able to resist. Even if he wins, you still have a hold.
Okay.
Then, so this is just to try to chuck him in.
I'm gonna try to chuck him in.
All right. So this is basically a brawn versus brawn.
Good. I got a legendary.
And I got a good.
Aha!
So you won by. You got him by three.
Chuck him in there.
And there he goes. We have one down. One down, one to go. All right, Perry. Time. It's hammer time.
It's hammer time. Yeah, I feel like
we should put on some MC Hammer. That's just too legit.
He's going to go aggressive this time as well.
Oh, boy. Okay. So aggressive versus not.
Versus just normal, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Ah. Ah. That's just going to be a great.
I also got a great.
All right, we're tying.
It's another standoff. Well, he's holding his own, but he's obviously not feeling comfortable enough just bull rushing you. So he's kind of still keeping his distance, kind of dancing around the brazier. But he also just heard a, as he glances over his shoulder, he notices he's outnumbered. All right, so we're to the next exchange. So it looks like the guard that is remaining is going to do everything he can to keep himself away from Bovar. So it looks like he's going to try to go. He's going to quickly. It looks like he's pouncing to lunge like right at you, try to take you out quick before the other guy gets over there. What are you going to do this exchange?
Jump
the pit.
No. No. Let's not. Suddenly, okay. The battle
let's
is
pitched Bovar's agility.
At what point, you know, at what point do I do something just to show something off for this thing? That would be suicide. No, that would be a very bad idea with this character.
Well, then the combat would continue, just free falling. Yeah,
yeah. It's like
fighting off
like
forever.
The Balrog.
Stop for Santa. Unpack some rations.
Yeah, he's not dead yet. Bovar is going to move over here and grab this gold plate thing that, like this little holy, I think you put holy water in. He's just going to grab it and, like a frisbee, wing it at this dude.
All right.
And try to bomb
it. So basically, Bovar will be using his ranged weapons as because he's basically throwing an item,
mm-hmm.
and he's going to be trying to take out the guard with the large platter.
You better roll well and not hit Harry.
So I mentioned before, he's going aggressive. He looks like he wants to just come in and take you out. And are
I'm
you going
defensive.
Defensive. Buying time. So that means you get a plus two to your roll.
Alright, and defense would be which one of
It would be your skill. You're just adding a plus two to it. So even though you're basically fending him off with your hammer, I would still just use your melee, but you're gonna add a plus two to whatever your total is.
Got it. That was terrible, but so it's going to be just another grade again.
Just another great.
Just another
just
great.
Just a
great. I have standards, sir.
And does that total or?
No, that was just my straight roll plus my with my main.
So you actually are a plus four then.
Yeah.
Total.
So plus
okay.
four. So I got a legendary then total.
Excellent. And what did you get for your toss?
A good,
which is what I got.
Oh.
So right. We tied on that. So one of the things now, technically, it's not a 2-on-1 because it's one's ranged and one's melee. If Bovar was to close in and they were both attacking the guard at the same time, then we would have an outnumbering rule. So when a character's outnumbered. The outnumbered character gets a minus one for every creature beyond the first around them. So if this guard was surrounded by four people, he'd be at a minus three for his action. To make it matters even worse for the outnumbered person, they must tie or beat everyone they're fighting to win their action. Otherwise, they don't get their action. So this is a game mechanic that would be really, really fun in like a zombie apocalypse type game or something where there's like lots of not very high powered things, but lots of them. Because being outnumbered in this game can get you into trouble really, really quick. So basically the effect was you successfully easily stayed out of his way. Partially, was partially dodging a large metal platter that was coming in.
I just stood behind the hammer. I just blocked everything.
So being that it was a tie for this one, yeah, it just missed him. But now he realizes he's kind of a 2-on-1. He's kind of doing this back and forth. Back and forth, like, what to do. He still feels like his chances are better with you because you
haven't
hit him
yet.
So we're to a new exchange. I think we're on exchange 5 already. So what is Perry going to do?
Perry's going back to basics, and she would like to kind of look at Bovar and kind of try to send the signal, like, you come in from one way, I'll come in from the other, and let's try to smack one half of his body off of, and while he cleaves it in half.
Sweet.
Excellent. And so,
I'll cut him in half, and she knocks the top half into the pit.
Yep.
So Bovar, you will be engaging in this exchange.
Yes, I will.
So for this exchange, since you're in the same zone, and you're going to be attacking melee, you guys will have him outnumbered. So mm-hmm. he'll be at a minus one for his action. So he is going to go cautious, although he's still going to try to take you out, but he's going to go with a cautious stance. So let's go ahead and we'll resolve, since you're already engaged with him, we'll do you first, and then
okay.
we'll roll Bovar in.
And I'm going aggressive. I'm taking an aggressive stance once more.
Okay, so that was just a good.
Okay, I rolled fair.
Good,
yep.
And I'm cautious, so I get I'm at good as well.
Sorry.
There's another tie. So he's at good.
I am at great.
Great, so you beat him by one,
mm-hmm.
but you get to add two to that,
mm-hmm.
which gives you three. And going back to our character sheet real quick,
mm-hmm.
you can see that 3 points of damage is a serious wound.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go into the wounds really quick, so now because we actually have some to deal with. So a minor wound gives the target a minus one, but only for the next exchange, and then it goes away. So it only lasts, it's a temporary advantage. It'll just last the next advantage. So maybe you popped him in his nose and his eyes got a little teared up for a second, or maybe when he went to sidestep, you know, he kind of rolled his ankle a little bit and he's kind of hobbling for a second. However you want to describe a minor wound, but it's basically just something that's only going to affect him the next exchange and then it goes away. A serious wound is also a minus one. But it would last for the entire, well, it'll actually last for a day, but it will last throughout the fight. So whoever gets that wound will have it at least through the rest of this scene. The other thing is there is a thing called a gut check for serious and more serious critical and traumatic wounds. They make a gut check. This is against their will. The gut check determines if anything extra bad happens. So, for example, with a serious wound, if a character fails their gut check, they're stunned for the next round, which is all they can do is cover up and defend themselves. They can't move, can't do a maneuver, can't attack. You're basically just kind of spending an exchange, just trying not to die. If you fail your, if you fail on a critical, you're dying. That's the character condition that you get. Now, you're not going to just die randomly, or you don't. It basically, it's a narrative term, but it means like after the fight, if you don't do something to stabilize that character, they will bleed out and die. Okay. Now, a traumatic wound. If you take 7 or more points in a single exchange, you are taken out with a traumatic wound. Traumatic wound, you're automatically dying if you take a traumatic wound. The gut check determines if you are instantly killed or if you're just dying. So that's how those work. So he took a serious wound, which means he'll be at a minus one for the rest of the for the rest of the exchange. And there we go. And if he fails, he will be stunned the next round. All he'll be able to do is defend himself. And oh, and one thing, when you are stunned, you can't use stances either. So you can't do like, I'm stunned, so I'm gonna go full defensive. It doesn't work that way. You're not really strategically defending. You're literally just covering up and just trying to survive for a few seconds.
All right, can I say I cut his ear off?
What's that?
I cut his ear off. Like, it's something he can still fight, but he's like, ah, God!
Just, oh, totally. And this is where, like I said, this is where it comes into, once the players are comfortable with the game, winner gets to describe. So as long as their description matches the severity of the outcome, you should totally roll with it.
I mean, yeah, that's a pretty major thing, but it won't stop him from fighting.
It won't stop him, and it doesn't really impede him, except that, yeah, you know.
No, he won't hear as much.
Yeah. Out of that side. All right, but he has survived. Where are we at? I just got a little bit turned around because I was explaining the...
Oh, so... So they...
They were a standoff. Mm-hmm. She was able to fend him off.
And I beat him by threes, which is a serious...
You got the serious one.
Oh, were you about to roll to see if he's...
Oh, for his... that's it. Gut check.
Yep.
Gut check!
See if he... Maybe he got only half cleaved.
Surprisingly, he's instead of shirking and crying about his ear, he's really pissed now. So he basically succeeded with his gut check. So
right.
He's still outnumbered, and he's at a minus one, which means for the next exchange he's gonna be at a minus two. Actually, for the rest of the fight, he's gonna be at a minus two. So you guys basically have him outnumbered. You got him injured. What is Bolvar going to do now?
I'm gonna go at him with my axe again. I like your plan of cut in half and smash top. So I'm gonna go aggressive again. Bovar is a very aggressive type of fighter.
I will go aggressive as well for this.
Excellent.
And we're gonna try again. I really want to hit this guy now. Really bad.
He's gonna go aggressive only because he's mad. Right. Nobody said that guards were smart. So, tactically, he should be covering up and going full defense, but he's really pissed about his ear. So he's just like, screw it, I'm either going to die or I'm going to take somebody with me.
It was his favorite ear.
Yeah.
It was his favorite ear. Yeah.
It had his earring.
Yeah. Had his earring.
One earring. Very 90s of him.
All right, so let's go ahead and just all roll, and we'll see what you guys have to beat. He's going aggressive as well. He's at minus two. Oh, my God.
All right.
You have to beat a minus two.
Oh.
You got better than I did.
I didn't roll too, let's see.
I think Perry's going to bring the
thunder. It would have been a total of 6 minus my 1 because I went reckless.
So 5.
But
then add 2.
Super legendary.
7.
So super duper legendary.
So you're at 7.
Yeah.
Total. Mm-hmm. Okay.
For what it's worth, I did all my things. I got a superb, which is still way over whatever he got.
So you beat him by 5.
Yeah, plus 2.
Plus your 2.
Yeah.
So you both beat him by 7.
Oh, this
so which means you both
did, I think we did it.
Yeah.
You both did 7 points of damage, which 7 is a traumatic wound.
Double
so
trauma.
Now, at this point, they get to basically cohort together and figure out how they want to describe this poor, poor guard just trying to feed his family. Tried his demise.
Oh, so it's beyond that.
So, well, how does it happen? How do you guys destroy this guard?
Well, I come in first with the side swipe through the gut.
Yeah, he comes in from the opposite direction I'm swinging. Yeah. So we're doing that.
Yeah. And yeah, kind of almost anime style, the axe goes through him, but then the hammer comes around
right
back.
Right into the face, and I want his face to just kind of be blown off, like full gore, and then into the pit.
And the whole
top half goes into the pit.
And the legs are still standing there. And it's all done in that Judge Dredd slow-mo. Like,
almost just, like, just hands
everything's
for a
super
second.
Slow. It's all... And you're like, oh, like, kind of try not to vomit watching this movie.
And just for extra measure, Perry is going to smash the legs down as well.
Nice.
Just into the ground.
Yeah.
Fatality.
Finish him.
That was absolutely a Mortal Kombat move right there.
So, success. Two guards came in.
Huzzah!
And they're both really, really dead now.
Two blood and gore.
So as you can see, this was just a little quick basic scenario. Two on two. We got into the zones. We got into how the simultaneous actions work. We got to cover a little bit about the wounds. But as you can see, even if you take out all the explanation, this combat would have taken less than 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things that when I was trying to put this game together, that was the most important thing for me, was trying to make combat less tedious, make it faster, but still keep some strategy in there, still keep some tactics in there. And most importantly, the reason I went with a Fudge or Fate style game was the fact that it allows for so much more interpretation by the players. Because we've established what a serious wound is. A serious wound lasts for a day or two. So that could be a cracked rib or a bruised rib or, you know, a twisted knee or something like that. It's going to heal pretty quickly and they'll have a limp for a day or two, but they'll be fine. Critical wound lasts for like a week. So a minimum of a week, but it could last a couple weeks. That could be something a little bit more serious. And a traumatic wound is something that was bad enough to take them out. That could be internal bleeding. That could be broken bones, severed limbs. You know, you can have lots of fun with a traumatic wound.
Chopped in half. Yeah.
And one of the things I also wanted to point out is... The one thing that I'm kind of lucky here is both of my players here today are pretty experienced with Dungeons & Dragons, which is obviously the most popular role-playing game in the world and probably will be forever. And what I like about bringing people from that system into this system is when you give somebody the context for wounds. I don't know how it is at most people's tables, but the descriptions I got today were amazing and really detailed, because it's not just, oh, I did 20 hit points, right? You know a specific type of wound and you kind of know what you're trying to do. You put those two things together and you can really describe some fun stuff. So that's basically the combat system in a nutshell. We got through it relatively quickly. I'm going to be doing more videos on like fighting large creatures, fighting swarms. I want to also get into like where magic comes into play, because magic is not very combat friendly in this game, because it's a slower process, but there are magical items and there are types of things that Perry's character, her hammer actually, she built has an alchemical head on it that she can trigger basically with a small explosive that puts a lot of oomph behind the strike once it hits something. It basically like, is it like a spring-loaded kind of a thing at the head? So
yeah, it's a pressure.
Not only does she have the momentum of the swing, then it's doing something on top of that. So there's things like that where it gets a little bit more complicated. Also, range combat can be a little bit tricky for a lot of folks, figuring in range and things like that. I'm going to do more videos. I just wanted to give a real basic on how quick it is to set up a scene and how quickly it plays and how the descriptions work. So hopefully you got a lot out of this, and I want to thank you guys again. And don't forget, Rudecraft, and I'll be posting links on the video so you can go check it out. There's lots of different styles, lots of swag, all different types of things. Didn't you say you can do like beer steins or something?
I have, I can do beer steins, coasters, t-shirts, of course, sweatshirts, shoes.
Journals,
yeah, the journals are pretty cool. Stickers, stickers are awesome. The Rudecraft stickers are set at cost. I'd make absolutely nothing off of it because I want you guys to put those everywhere you can. Just about everything. Shoes, dresses, all kinds of fun stuff. I've got a whole bunch of different styles on there as well. So please go check it out. That'd be fantastic.
And then at least for your bags, maybe have some email address or some contact.
Sure. If you guys want a dragon bag, I don't have an Etsy or anything. Right now, I'm just kind of working off of my cosplay page, which is Azreal Cosplay, A-Z-R-E-A-L-E Cosplay. And it's just on Facebook. It's pretty easy to find. Hit me up. We appreciate.
Get bags, buy stuff, play the game, have fun. If you have any questions,
hell yeah.
This will be on our YouTube page. You can post any questions. I'm pretty good at responding. And there'll be lots more videos, probably, hopefully, with this, our same two characters, doing some other different scenarios. So until then, take care and have fun.
See ya.
Bye.